So now we'll get into the concept of introduce, practice, and master, right? So introduce, this is probably something that you've experienced all your life, but maybe haven't really recognized it happening. And you will start to see it all over the place in games and all over the place with different mechanics. So giving the player a mechanic for the first time, you want it to be very easy and straightforward to understand, right? And it should be in a safe space. So when I learn this new mechanic, there's no major punishment if I screw up, or there's no major time constraint, right? So if we think about with Mario, right when we learn that jump mechanic, we learn jump right at the beginning of the game, right? And they've done, and then we're talking about original Mario, like they've done a great job of not having to, you know, have text on screen or anything like that. You know, so yes, the controller was simple at the time. There was only two buttons, but right when the game started, there was a Goomba coming at you, right? Right when the game starts, right? So there's that image of the game. So you basically have that pretty much the time from the when the level loads up to when that Goomba approaches you to learn jump. That is the introduction to the jump mechanic. So in this scenario, yes, you can die. There is some punishment for failure, but it is pretty minimal because you start right back in the same exact location. Right, if you got all the way to the end and died and then got back, you know, and got sent to the beginning of the level, that would be a bit higher punishment. Or, you know, you basically the game ended as soon as you died one time. That would be punishment, right? But you lose one life, you learn, okay, I can't run into Goombas, and then you start back at the beginning, right? But you're introduced to that jump mechanic. And here as well, you can say you're still being introduced to the mechanics so you can jump and break these bricks, right? Very safe place for players to understand, okay, I can do this action, I can jump. Then getting into practice, you can start to use the mechanic in at least in a more advanced or difficult setup, right? So practicing proves that the player understands how to efficiently use the mechanic, right? How to effectively use that mechanic in different ways or use it, you know, efficiently. So continuing with the Mario example, right, so yeah, you can also incorporate them with other mechanics as well. So in the Mario example here, right, this is right after that first little section there where you're introduced to the Goomba and to jump. You'll see these two different pipes, right? So this is a very subtle way to teach the player. You can tap A to jump a certain height, or you can hold down A to jump even higher, right? So that's showing them how to efficiently use that jump mechanic in different ways, right? And then they continue to basically, you can really argue that, you know, the rest of the level you're practicing, or even maybe the rest of World 1, you're practicing the jump mechanic, right? So where the eventually, you know, in Mario at first, the gaps are very short, and then they start to become even longer, right? Or you jump from platform to platform, eventually the platforms start moving, right? That progression is starting to become more difficult over time. Right. So then mastery. Right. Mastery is a challenging setup that tests the skills of the player. And this is definitely usually incorporated with other mechanics. Right. It can be the most challenging in the final, you know, someone had mentioned, you know, a quote unquote final boss. This would be like your final test and the final puzzle or the final challenge for the player using this mechanic. Right. So continuing with Mario in this top image up here. You'll see that this is from one of the castles, right, in World 5. Here we're jumping from platform to platform, and notice that, okay, now we are punished if we miss the jump because we're going to fall in lava, right? So it's a pretty much a higher punishment. And now we're incorporating other mechanics where we have this fireball that's shooting up out of the lava over time, so we have to time our jump there, as well as we have the fireballs that are spinning around this block, right, that Mario needs to avoid, right? So we have this other element of if we die, we're going to get punished and go back to the beginning of the castle, as well as, you know, you have these other hazards you need to avoid. And then down here, I found this, and I thought this was a great example of someone that has practiced this mechanic and knows it so well, maybe even better than the developers, that they can show the ability to do some amazing things with that jump mechanic. So that's really pushing it to the limits and showing that they understand how to, you know, use that mechanic as effectively as possible, right? So think about when you're designing your mechanics, different and creative ways that you can use your mechanics in your level, right? So if you have, conveyor belts or force fields or exploding barrels, try and come up with different and creative ways that you're using them throughout your level. And if you want to have more than one, right? So or more than one practice or more than one mastery, that's totally fine. So if you want the player to practice twice with one of your mechanics, just come up with those ideas now and get them down on paper. The minimum is three for each one, but I'm definitely fine with you doing more than just three, right? If you do introduce, practice, master, or something along those lines. So here is an IPM chart from one of our final project teams, and I just like to go over this to show you IPM on a larger scale. So this is going to represent IPM across an entire game, right? So on the left over here, these are all of the mechanics that the game has that the player needs to learn. So what this was, that this was a this game was called Carbon Copy. It was basically a 2D side scroller. You could make copies of yourself. You made this derp clone, which just stood in place. You had the boom clone, which would pretty much spawn in and then 3 seconds later would explode. And then you had the poof clone, which would disappear after 3 seconds. So you have these three different types of clones. You can make copies of yourself, and they had these other mechanics that they worked well with. So you make a derp clone and it stood in place on a pressure pad. So across the top over here, these are the level numbers, right? So starting at level one, and they had 19 levels in their game. And then what they've done here, so this is before they even started building the game, is they would plan out where the player is going to be introduced, where they're going to practice, and where they're going to master each one of these mechanics, right? And you see when they've done this, it starts to form this curve, right? So you can see we're always being introduced to new interactions, new things up until level 13, right? And then we're able to continue to develop those skills over the course of the entire game. So if something like this didn't exist, right? If we just introduced everything in level one, it would make players feel very overwhelmed, right? And there's just so much to learn at once. There's just so much going on that it's hard to take it all in at once. It's going to overwhelm players. You're going to lose a lot of your audience. But then the audience that does actually get through level one, right? They've been introduced to every single mechanic in the game, and now they've made it to level 10, and now they're going to have the opposite effect. Now they're going to be bored, right? Because now they're in level 10. They've seen everything already. Everything has been introduced, so there's nothing new to give the player to keep them going. So they might lose interest because there's nothing new going on. So this curve is pretty much, the player's dopamine drip along the game, right? To where they're playing along, you give them something new, then they continue to play, you give them something new, right? And almost like that pacing to give them a reward or give them a collectible, give them something new as they continue to play, right? As well as challenge them on things they've already learned, right? So you can see, in level seven, we're being, challenged with some of the interactions that we've already learned before previously in a harder way, right? So the jumping becomes much more precise, or the timing of things becomes much more precise, and continuing on that way. And then lastly, why this is really awesome and really helpful is you can actually start to build and visualize what the levels look like with a chart like this, right? So again, we're all working on a team. And we have different people working on different levels, right? So if we're working on, say, I'm tasked with working on level five, right? I have to build level five, six, and seven, right? Those are my levels that have been assigned to me, right? So in level five, we now know everything that that level has to include, right? So it has to be a mastery of moving and jumping, practicing interacting with the environment, a mastery of pressure pads and doors and gates, practicing lever and the springboard, and introducing the crusher for the first time. Everything you can see here that's included vertically is everything that will be included in that level, right? So it's a really good way to divvy out the tasks of the actual, building of the levels and making sure that everyone is following and, making sure that level 10 isn't harder than, level 15 and things like that, and having that progression building off of one another. So just a little bit of insight. Again, this isn't anything you're going to be building or anything you're responsible for. You're just going to be making two mechanics over one level or one part of the level. So just know that this is something that you can start to design as you go forward into building larger games and larger projects that have multiple levels and several mechanics that the player's learning over time. So definitely a really good example of an IPM chart on a larger scale.